Welcome to episode 357 of the Selling Your Screenplay podcast. I'm Ashley Scott Myers, screenwriter and blogger at sellingyourscreenplay.com. Today I'm interviewing Irish writer-director David Freeney, who just did a film called Dating Amber, which is a queer coming-of-age comedy. We talk through his journey as a filmmaker, which started with him doing super low-budget shorts and eventually getting grant money to shoot bigger and bigger shorts, and then he now has two feature films under his belt. We talk about his new film, but I also was curious to hear what he had to say about getting the grant money from the Irish government. That's not something that we have here in the United States, but it's something that I hear about from other countries, other filmmakers outside of the USA. So I was interested to talk to him about this, how you get the grants, apply for the grants, and ultimately what those actually look like in terms of helping you produce your project. So stay tuned for that interview. If you find this episode valuable, please help me out by giving me a review in iTunes or leaving a comment on YouTube or retweeting the podcast on Twitter or liking or sharing it on Facebook. These social media shares really do help spread word about the podcast, so they're very much appreciated. Any websites or links that I mention in the podcast can be found on my blog in the show notes. I also publish a transcript with every episode in case you'd rather read the show or look at something later on. You can find all the podcast show notes at www.sellingyourscreenplay.com/podcast, and then just look for episode number 357. If you want my free guide, How to Sell a Screenplay in 5 Weeks, you can pick that up by going to sellingyourscreenplay.com/guide. It's completely free. You just put in your email address and I'll send you a new lesson once per week for 5 weeks, along with a bunch of bonus lessons. I teach the whole process of how to sell your screenplay in that guide. I'll teach you how to write a professional logline and query letter and how to find agents, managers, and producers who are looking for material. Really is everything you need to know to sell your screenplay. Just go to sellingyourscreenplay.com/guide. So now just a couple of quick words about what I'm working on. If you watch this podcast on YouTube, or even if you don't watch it on YouTube, I've created a second YouTube channel, which I will link to in the show notes. The URL is a bit hard to read. I think until you get a certain number of videos posted or subscriptions, they don't let you create a custom URL. But I've created this second channel as a small clips channel where we put out small little pithy questions and answers from the interview. So it's usually like short clips from these exact interviews that you're listening to now, like this, but they're usually short 2 to 4 minutes that just highlight some question and answer. So have a look at that if you think it might be interesting, and please do subscribe. I'm just trying to kick off this channel and kind of see how it does. We're still moving along with my mystery thriller feature film, The Rideshare Killer. We're moving really into the next phase. I'm getting the trailer done. I've got my trailer editor all set up. Next week I'm going to get him the footage. He's going to start cutting that. I'm starting to interview some poster artists. So I'm going through that process as well. And then I've also going to be adding some motion graphics at the very end of the movie. It's like a 1 year later thing. And there's like this little commercial for this woman's new business. It's kind of hopefully shows her sort of her change in her arc. She's created this new business. And so it's kind of like an advertisement. So I'm going to do a little motion graphics, the kind you would see in like an advertisement. So I've got to find a motion graphic artist that can do, someone that's done a lot of advertising. I mean, you see these things on YouTube, just little logos that spin and that sort of stuff. These are fun projects, at least I think so. They're sort of the icing on the cake that is this very long process of making a movie. Getting the trailer done will be super exciting, because then I actually have something that I can start to show people. But anyways, those are the main things I've been working on over the last week. So now let's get into the main segment. Today I'm interviewing writer-director David Freeney. Here is the interview. Welcome, David, to the Selling Your Screenplay podcast. I really appreciate you coming on the show with me today.
Thank you so much for having me. It's great.
So to start out, maybe you can tell us a little bit about your background. Where did you grow up and how did you get interested in the entertainment business?
Yeah, of course. So I grew up in a rural kind of town in Ireland, outside Dublin. And I always wanted to be a filmmaker, but didn't know how to go about it. I just kind of rented out films a lot. After college, I did a master's in film, in theory. And then I started working as a runner in post-production house and worked my way up through the post house. And at the side, I was making short films with friends and just learning how to do that. And then they started doing quite well and getting into festivals. And then we started getting funding to make short films with Screen Ireland and RTE, which is a kind of a national broadcaster. And that just started kind of gradually leading to being a full-time filmmaker. And developing my first feature, The Cures, with Screen Ireland. And here I am now.
Gotcha. Yeah, gotcha. Okay, well, that's good. And I think we can appreciate sort of the progression of that. Let's dig in a little bit about that. I'm from the United States, and I know I talk to a lot of European filmmakers, and there's always these grants that you're talking about, like you got these grants to do these short films. Maybe you can talk about that a little bit. How do you get into position to get some of that grant money? It sounds like you did a couple shorts, basically just on spec. You just went out, did a couple shorts. Was that enough to kind of get you into this grant program? But maybe talk about that a little bit. How can other people potentially get access to some of this grant money?
No, of course. Yeah. I mean, it's, you know, we're so lucky in many of the European countries, like in Ireland, to have these funds. Because I know in America and other countries, they don't have them. And I think they're so vital to have that kind of support for young filmmakers. So yeah, I made a lot of short films with no money, just with friends and broken cameras. And some of them are really, really bad. But you learn your craft a little bit. And you eventually start making good ones. And once they started getting really good, we started getting into big film festivals around the world. And that started getting you noticed by the different agencies in Ireland. And those agencies used to have funds that allowed you to finish a short film in order to kind of get into those festivals. So yeah, it was kind of proving you had a kind of a smattering of talent with those things, and then you write short film scripts and you submit them to the various grants. And you know, I submitted about 20 before I actually ended up getting one. So you have to really persevere, and there isn't that many. There's only like 4 a year, and I eventually started getting them, and I ended up getting 3 or 4. And you start working with budgets and learning how a big actual set works, and working with professional crews, and really kind of just figuring out how it will work on an actual feature film or a TV series. So it's a very, you know, it's quite a slow, methodical kind of process. And it's not easy. You know, those grants are really hard to get. Like, as I mentioned, I failed a lot to get them. And each one of those kind of rejections is heartbreaking, because when you're in a small country, even though we have funds, there's nothing else. No, I've been making short films without any money. I think this with friends is kind of the best way to start, you know.
Yeah, for sure. Sound advice. So how did you make that leap from doing these short films to doing The Cured? What was the process there? Had you been writing feature scripts all along? And just in a nutshell, again, well, I want to get into Dating Amber, but just in a nutshell, how did you get that movie produced, The Cured, and how did you make that leap from shorts to features?
Yeah, I mean, it's so funny, because when you're making short films and you're kind of making them in that kind of ecosystem of Ireland, you kind of get used to just writing short films because you're making them. Then it was, so I've been writing a lot, but I haven't been writing features. And then I had the idea for The Cured. So I wrote that on spec, and I used the first draft of that to get funding from Screen Ireland to develop it further with my producers. And so I ended up writing it on spec to get the funding from the government body. And then before we, I was still just a lonely filmmaker, and it was a big film in many ways. So we ended up then making a proof of concept short film that, again, very luckily, Screen Ireland financed. And that was just kind of a snippet from the world that proved how I would envisage it and how we would direct it, and, you know, to go out with the scripts to the financiers. So, you know, financing of The Cured was a very long, bumpy road, where financing came and went, and, you know, it had its ups and downs, as I think every filmmaker can identify with. But it was, again, just a real lesson in perseverance.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, so let's dig into your latest film, Dating Amber. Maybe to start out, you can give us a quick pitch or log line. What is Dating Amber all about?
So Dating Amber is a comedy drama about two gay teenagers in a rural town in Ireland who decide to stake a straight relationship in order to stop all the taunts and speculation around them. So yeah, it's a kind of a platonic love story about these two kids, Eddie and Amber, as they kind of navigate the world.
Yeah, and where did this idea come from? What was the genesis of this story?
I mean, so it's very autobiographical. I'm very much so Eddie in the film. You know, I grew up in the town it's set. You know, my dad is in the army, and I very much so struggled to come out. And I had a friend in school who later came out to be a lesbian. And it was in hindsight, I just thought how easy it would have been had we just faked this and pretend to be straight and avoided a lot of abuse. So that was the genesis of the idea.
Mm-hmm.
It's definitely as autobiographical as I'm probably ever going to get with a script.
Yeah, gotcha. So maybe we can talk about the writing process a little bit. What does your process look like just in terms of where do you typically write? Are you someone that has a home office? Do you go to Starbucks and write with some background noise? And when do you typically write? You write in the morning, evening, afternoon? What does your writing process look like?
Yeah, well, like it's changed over the years. I used to write at night. I used to find it really easy to write in those late hours when you're tired and your kind of self-editing voice telling you it's crap isn't really working. So I used to write at night a lot, but now I kind of train myself to write more during the day. And I write by just writing down notes and notes and notes and kind of throwing things around like a jigsaw puzzle. And before you know it, you have about a 20-page document of just kind of indecipherable notes only to you. And then I start kind of fleshing that out into a script. And I generally, once I have those notes in an order that makes sense to me, that's when I generally start writing my first draft. And once I spend a lot of time with that kind of map. So when I start writing my first draft, I very often write my first draft quite quickly because I've spent a very long time, like months, putting the plan together. I wrote my first draft quite quickly then, and then I just do rewrites as you go. But my first drafts are usually quite good. And with Dating Amber in particular, it came together very quickly because I've been living with the story and the ideas for such a long time. Just come out in many ways fully formed, which was, you know, great. It's kind of a slow on off process. I don't really, sometimes I go to cafes, I have a home office that I use sometimes. You know, I write when I get an idea.
Yeah. And I'm curious, since you did a lot of short films before doing features, and it sounds like you were writing a lot of these shorts, how did that process change? And I know when I talk to a lot of, filmmakers that do a lot of shorts, it sounds like you're not this, but I'm just curious sort of to get your take on it. A lot of the short filmmakers, they can write the entire script without doing a lot of prep work, outlining and index cards and stuff. Just because it's a short piece, you know, you can kind of muscle your way through that. It sounds like you do a lot of preparation work. But what do you find as sort of the differences in your preparation for a feature versus a short?
Well, no, I think that's right. I think when I was writing shorts, you have the idea and it can come very quickly. You can write the first draft in one sitting. But obviously a feature is a much different endeavor. And I think the structure and fashion of a feature is much different and it's much more involved. And it takes a long time. I think the big lesson coming from shorts to features is actually just patience. The patience you need to write a feature and the kind of legwork you need to put into each character's arcs and journeys. And I think, I think short films are such a great training ground for features, but I think the problem very often, and I admit I probably got into that too when I was younger, is when you're so used to writing a short piece, you almost train yourself out of how a feature script works in terms of structure and, moments. So I think it's a totally different muscle, It's like running a marathon.
And what does your development process look like? And I'd be curious just to talk specifically about Dating Amber. Like you had a first draft that it sounds like you were pretty confident with. Who do you send it to? Who do you get notes from? Do you have sort of a agent manager that you trust? Do you have other writer friends? What does your development process look like on something like this?
Absolutely. I had my producer on this who also produced my first feature. He's a really good friend of mine. I was in film school with her. So that was always a straight go-to. My brother's a writer, so I always send him stuff as well. And he's always a very trusted reader. And I have a very dear friend in development who's a very trusted reader as well. So they're always the three people I'll send things to straight away when I'm happy to go out. I'm happy to kind of send them things at an earlier stage than I would send it to anybody else. I get their notes and sometimes I'll disagree with them entirely and sometimes there's something really interesting in there. But I like to kind of continue to develop. So once you have a strong first draft or a strong draft that you can start going out with, I think it's important that the producer can start the financing process and start that process while you're then fine-tuning the script. Because it's never, for me, the script is never done until you're shooting it. So I continue to kind of tweak it and develop it as I go along. There's never really an end date. You know, you might, and I find for myself that, particularly with this film, Dating Under, because it's a comedy and it's all about how things sound, you find things change then when you start rehearsing with your actors and you realize what's working and what's not working. And we ended up casting this film very early when we were still financing. So I had the opportunity to, you know, do table reads with the cast and see what joke's working and what joke's not working. Or then another joke will come to me because an actor did something really funny. So it was a really, it was a really strong first draft that we were able to start the financing process with. But then I kept working away at it and fine tuning it and making sure it was the best version there could be, and making sure with this particularly that, you know, the jokes really landed, because writing a funny joke is very different to having a funny joke performed. So it was all about everything landed.
Yeah, yeah. And you mentioned this producer that you had worked with on The Cured. How early in this process did you bring that producer into writing Dating Amber? And I'm curious, did you even pitch the idea, like before you even started writing, did you tell this producer, hey, I got this idea, and start to get feedback even in the very early stages?
Yeah, so we finished The Cured, and literally we were on the plane. We got The Cured into Toronto, and then we were on the plane back in Toronto. I sent them the treatment for Dating Amber, sent them the 10-page treatment for the film, and I was beginning to write it as a script, but I gave it to them first because I wanted them to produce it and everything, and that's where we began the relationship. And I always think it's good to begin with, if you have somebody you trust as a producer, I think it's good to start a relationship early and start that process earlier, because then they start, you know. Again, in Ireland, we're fortunate that we can get development funding to write the script from Screen Ireland and start that process early. And once you kind of are in with those development bodies, you're more likely to get production financing from them. And that's always going to be the cornerstone of your financing for a feature film. So, yeah, I like to do it early and that relationship early.
Yeah. And I'm curious, The Cured, sort of a zombie horror genre film, obviously Dating Amber is more of an art house indie. Was there any pushback going from The Cured to Dating Amber, just in terms of genre, from your producer, from your distributors, from your financiers, just because it was such a different film than The Cured?
I mean, not from my producers, but certainly, or my agents or anything, but certainly I think when you make a horror film, you get sent a lot of horror material then to direct. Mm-hmm. And I think it's very hard for people to watch The Cured and say, this guy could do a comedy. So yeah. I understand that I wasn't necessarily going to be the first person that people would consider for this. So I think the trick was, not in writing, but in directing, just proving that I was able to deliver a really funny film, because I'd done it in short films, but I hadn't done it in a feature film. So yeah, that's where it got tricky, you know, because you have people saying that this is a good script, but David isn't a comedy director, or, you know, he's a horror director, or, you know, whatever. So that's when it got tricky. But certainly I always had the support of my producer, which is always great and always been amazing with me. So it was just the kind of wider financing when you go out to New Orleans. People are very quick to put you in a box as a filmmaker.
And I'm curious, though, because that's sort of just, you know, conventional wisdom in screenwriting is you can be put in a box. As you do one movie, people will expect you to do something somewhat similar. Did you make it just as an artist? Was this a conscious choice? I don't want to be in that box? Or was it just more a choice of, this is the project I'm interested in doing?
Yeah, it was more, this is the project I'm interested in doing. I think I started writing Dating Amber before I made The Cured. You know, at the time, I thought it might have been my first feature, but just things happen differently and financing happen differently. But, you know, I have such a wide taste in film and genres of film and literature that, yeah, I never fathomed the idea of just being a horror director or just being a comedy director. I think it's, you know, I always want to jump around. And I think, you know, like I've just written a sci-fi, I have a period drama in development. You know, I kind of want to make sure that I can go from one to the other. And I think that's how you keep it fresh and exciting for yourself as a writer. So, yeah, I'm just not that interested in repeating myself. which is tricky because people want you to repeat yourself.
Yeah, for sure. So now you're done with the script. You went through this development process. You got notes from these contacts. What were those next steps? Once you had a script that was ready to go, what were those next steps? Did you try and bring on cast? Did your producer go out and try and raise money? What did that look going from having a polished script to getting it into production? How did you guys get the money?
So we got it into development screen on it, and then the very first step we made was we sent it to Sharon. I wrote the role of the mother for Sharon Corrigan, because I'm seeing incredible talent. We sent the draft to her agent, and she really responded. And a week later, I was having coffee with Sharon saying she'd love to do it. So the very first step was casting. It was casting those parent roles and getting kind of some talent there that would be attractive to kind of wider financiers. And then we started doing the rest of the casting, the kids and stuff, and submitting it to funding rounds and going out to sales agencies in the UK and financiers. And you just slowly kind of get it together over time. I don't think you can take it one step at a time. I think you kind of have to be doing a few things at once with it. It was casting and financing kind of happened at the same time. And it's that thing that people don't want to finance you until you have cast. So you have to kind of go with both.
And I'm curious, just in terms of the financing, what are some of your takeaways? Now, you've been through this process getting a, an indie horror film financed versus getting a art house, coming of age gay comedy financed. What are some of your sort of takeaways? Is one more difficult? Is one easier? Is there different things you have to do to kind of position yourself to get that financing?
I mean, I think the big lesson with filmmaking in general is just you have to be really tenacious. You have to really persevere because you're going to get a lot of no's. Mm-hmm. But certainly, the first film was really hard to finance, but definitely on paper, making a horror film is more financeable than making a queer comedy. Dating Amber was relatively easy to finance because it was my second feature and you've kind of proven some mettle. But I think some of the things we got from certain financiers who didn't end up being involved in the film, we used to get people saying things like it's not sad enough to be a queer film, or it's too funny to be a queer film. And I think very often people have very set expectations of what these types of films should be. And I think you have to be very careful that you stick to your guns and you stick to the film you want to make, because it's very easy to start changing it to satisfy somebody. But before you know it, you end up not having the film you wanted to make. And, with The Cured, I'm really proud of The Cured, but I'm sure there's points in that where I'm younger and more desperate and I probably make changes I didn't want to make. And in hindsight, you can regret those. So with Dating Amber, I was really dogged in this is the film I wanted to make. And, this is the reason I want to make it. We don't have enough queer comedies. We're so used to seeing a dark version of this story, and I want to make the film I wanted to see when I was younger. And so I think you have to just keep in mind why you want to tell this film, because it's not just about making a film, it's about saying something. And I think the financing process can really chip away at you, and you can end up not having the film you want to make made. And that's horrible. So yeah, it's such a gamble, it's such a lottery anyway, but you have to know why it is you want to make that particular film and stick to that.
Yeah. So for sure, that's great advice. How can people see Dating Amber? Do you know what the release schedule is going to be like?
Yeah. So it's out in the United States and Canada on the 10th of November. It'll be available on all digital platforms and whatnot. And yeah, you can see it. So it's really good. And I did some virtual cinemas, but damn COVID-19, we're in that. So you can rent it on iTunes and Fandango and all that stuff.
All right, perfect. And what's the best way for people to keep up with what you're doing? Twitter, Facebook, a blog, anything you're comfortable sharing, I will round up for the show notes.
Yeah, I have a Twitter handle that can always, where I just rant. And that would be the best.
Okay, perfect, perfect. Yeah, I'll grab that, as I said, for the show notes. Well, David, I really appreciate you coming on and talking with me today. Good luck with this film, and good luck with all your future projects as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll talk to you later.
Thank you so much for your time. Thank you.
Bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.
A quick plug for the SYS Screenwriting Analysis Service. It's a really economical way to get a high-quality professional evaluation on your screenplay. When you buy our three-pack, you get evaluations at just $67 per script for feature films and just $55 for teleplays. All the readers have professional experience reading for studios, production companies, contests, and agencies. You can read a short bio on each reader on our website, and you can pick the reader who you think is the best fit for your script. Turnaround time is usually just a few days, but rarely more than a week. The readers will evaluate your script on six key factors: concept, character, structure, marketability, tone, and overall craft, which includes formatting, spelling, and grammar. Every script will get a grade of pass, consider, or recommend, which should help you roughly understand where your script might rank if you were to submit it to a production company or agency. We can provide an analysis on features or television scripts. We also do proofreading without any analysis. We will also look at a treatment or outline and give you the same analysis on it. So if you're looking to vet some of your project ideas, this is a great way to do it. We will also write your logline and synopsis for you. You can add this logline and synopsis writing service to an analysis, or you can simply purchase this service as a standalone product. As a bonus, if your screenplay gets a recommend or a consider from one of our readers, you get to list the screenplay in the SYS Select database, which is a database for producers to find screenplays and a big part of our SYS Select program. Producers are in the database searching for material on a daily basis, so it's another great way to get your material in front of them. As a further bonus, if your script gets a recommend from one of our readers, your screenplay will get included in our monthly Best Of newsletter. Each month, we send out a newsletter that highlights the best screenplays that have come through our script analysis service. This is a monthly newsletter that goes out to our list of over 400 producers who are actively looking for material. So again, this is another great way to get your material out there. So if you want a professional evaluation of your screenplay at a very reasonable price, check out www.sellingyourscreenplay.com/consultants. Again, that's sellingyourscreenplay.com/consultants. On the next episode of the podcast, I'm going to be interviewing Sean C. Stevens, who just did a low-budget sci-fi thriller called Expulsion. We talk through that film and how he got to this point in his career writing and directing a feature film. So keep an eye out for that episode next week. That's the show. Thank you for listening.